I think just as we were wrapping up class last time, we saw how we can take multiple statements and turn them into a function. Because what we were doing before with the event and saying on click and having a JavaScript instruction, that would get really, how would I say, very clunky, very awkward, very difficult to read if we tried to do all our JavaScript code like that. So therefore, what we've done is we've changed, instead of having multiple lines with the on click event or the on mouse over or whatever, we've gone and we've taken and put a list of instructions in a function. And then we call that function when we need it. And that way, we just give one name for a function. It does its thing. That function can consist of as many lines of instructions as we need to get the job done. So let's take a look at what we did last time, and then we'll build on it. Here's the example that we were looking at last time. I'm going to take this and build on it. I want to review functions. Functions in our code do a couple things. One thing, it allows us to give a name to a list of instructions. So instead of having a list of instructions to do, we simply put them all under a function, we call the function, and we get all of them. So functions is a way. Functions are a way of grouping instructions into one. Functions allow us, secondly, to make our code more generic. All right? Because what we can do is we can add arguments to the function. All right? If you think about Excel, you know, there's one function to get a sum, right? You say equal sum. Then there's not like an instruction to get the sum for row one. A different instruction to get the sum for row 2 and row 3 and row 4 and row 5 and so on, right? There's one sum instruction, but then you say what cells you want the sum of. So you're giving an argument. You're giving additional information about what you want that function to do its thing on. All right? So let's look at the example we had last time. And we have our onClick to change colors that will change the color of each of these things. All right. First thing it does is it changes the first section to have a background color of red. It changes the second section to have a background color of yellow. All right. Now, what if we wanted, again, a different color scheme? Notice something about the function. Again, it has the word function, has the name of the function, that should match the name it's given down here. Parentheses. The empty parentheses indicate that this function doesn't have any arguments. So we're simply telling it to do that, but we're not giving it any additional information about, like, specifically what to do, like what colors to change. We're going to change that in a minute here. So I'm going to create a second function called function change colors to, and it will do the just exact opposite. It will change this one to yellow and this one to red. I'm picking changing colors just because it's something real simple and straightforward. It could literally be any of the attributes on the page, any of the attributes associated with any of the elements on the page. So we could be changing font size, we could be changing the font, we could be changing any number of different things. All right. So change colors changes the first section to have a red background and the second to have a yellow. Change colors too does the opposite. Again, the name of the function, the braces indicate the start and end of the function, and then we have our two JavaScript statements inside of it. So if I save this and open it up, if I hit this, it changes it. If I hit that, it does the opposite. Now, if you can imagine, what if I had a third color scheme that I wanted for whatever reason? Change them both to yellow. Change them both to red, let's say. I'd create a third function for the third color scheme. And so on. Well, as you can see, pretty soon we'd have to have one button for every color scheme that we wanted to have. All right? And that doesn't seem like a good way to do it. One warning sign to you as a coder is anytime you look and you see code that is duplicate, or code that is nearly duplicate, that ought to be a warning to you that you can do better, right? Our whole point in writing good code is not to repeat ourselves, right? That's why we put CSS in an external file, right? So we don't have to repeat ourselves. We can put it in one file, and all the web pages can share it. So anytime you look at code and see repeated code, and essentially all this code is repeated, the only difference is a specific color that we're changing the two things to. We can go and we can change, and by writing our function more generically, we can change it so that we don't need three functions for three color schemes. We have one function that can handle any color scheme that we want. All right? So that's what we're going to do here. I'm going to go in and I'm going to get rid of this, these two functions. And instead of saying red and yellow, I'm going to replace that with an argument. What do I mean by an argument? I mean, I'm going to tell the function when I run it what colors I want. All right? I'm going to tell it what colors I want. It's just like there's one sum function in Excel, right? Well, when you put the sum function in your worksheet, you say what you want the sum of. Well, here, there's going to be one change color function, and when we run that function, we're going to tell what colors we want. So I'm going to put in the parentheses arguments. And you can think of arguments as being placeholders. When I call this function, I'm no longer going to have empty parentheses here. I'm going to have values in here. All right? And those values are going to get put into these variables. All right? What are variables? Variables are literally references to memory locations where you're going to store values. So you can store values in those memory locations, and you can use values from those. All right. You use variables instead of hard-coded. Hard-coded is something like this, where we say we want it to be red. So doesn't matter how many times you click on it, it's always going to be red. With variables, we can vary what we put in there. We can change the color, and we can change it based on an argument. So to change this to use an argument, I put these in the parentheses simply to tell the function, hey, expect two different values, arg1 and arg2. And instead of making it red and yellow, we are going to set the background color of the first section to be whatever value is named in arg1, and whatever value is in the second argument, that's what's going to get be used for the second session. Now, can I leave these like that? Or is there a change I need to make to these? Well, let's look at the parentheses. Here we've said we need to supply two values. When we call the function, we have to actually supply those values. So we have to put in the parentheses the values that we want used. So I could make this one say red. And yellow. I can make this one say yellow, comma, red. And this one I can make, say, red, comma, red. So the difference between what we had before is, before we had three functions that were each hard-coded. The first function only changed to red and yellow. The second function only changed to yellow and red. And the third function only changed to red and red. All right? Now, we've changed this so that we have one function, but we have a flexible function. We have defined within the function two arguments, and these two arguments determine the specific color that these areas of the screen are going to get changed to. So notice how this lines up, and I'm going to try to make it small so that we get all of this on the same part of the screen. I define the function as having two arguments, argument 1 and argument 2. So when I call the function, I have to supply the two arguments, argument 1 and argument 2. All right. So how do those arguments work? Well, it's based strictly on position. Whatever value I put in, whatever value is first when I call the function, whatever argument I supply first, gets put in this variable, arg1. Whatever argument I have second gets put in arg2. So now arg1 and arg2 are variables. Variables have values, and the variable of arg1 is red, and the value of arg2 is yellow. So anywhere you see arg1, the value red is going to be used. And anywhere where you see the value arg2, yellow is going to be used in this case. So we come down here, document, get element by ID, first style background color arg2. I'm sorry, arg1. So what was arg1? Well, what did we call it with? red, so we're going to set it to red. The second section in, document get element by ID, second, style background color, whatever value is placed in R2. And what was placed in R2? Yellow. So we put these placeholders in when we define the function, and we use those values throughout the function. When we call the function, then, we have to supply values for those placeholders. Think of it almost like a Mad Lib, right? With a Mad Lib, you're asked for a noun, a verb, whatever, and then you fill them in and it fills in the story. These arguments represent blanks that are going to get filled in. All right, so here's a blank, here's a blank. Here's a blank, here's a blank. When we call the function, you need to give values for those blanks. They line up just in by position, so red goes in arg1, yellow goes in arg2, and wherever you see arg1 and arg2, those values get popped in. Now, there's no parentheses or there's no quotes around arg1 and arg2 because we don't literally want the letters arg1 or arg2. We want the value of that variable. All right? Now, we can change, and we did change, the second button to call the same function but give yellow and red. So what's the difference? Arg1 this time will have yellow and red, so we'll make the first one yellow and the second one red. And likewise, we have a third function that makes both of them red. So if we save this and refresh, I did something wrong. Let's see. I forgot the quote here. There we go. So I only had two buttons. There we go. Calls that. All right. Questions about this? This makes your functions more flexible. You don't have to write a separate function for every color combination. You write one function to change the colors, and then you give the color combination when you run it. And how do you give it? You give it via the arguments. And it's strictly a position thing. First argument gets put in here, second argument gets put in there. Questions on that? Here's one thing that is different about JavaScript than other languages. All right? Those of you who have done C sharp, when you call a function, you specify a type for an argument. You say that it's a string or a date or a number. Data types in Java are not typed that way. You may think it's a good thing, but it's not, because you could do something like this. You could put in a value that's clearly not right. So I'm going to change that function to say red 123. All right? Well, 123 isn't a color name, right? And if we save that, actually, It interpreted that as a decimal value, so it gave me a color. So I guess that's not bad. How about this? False. Yeah, there we go. All right. And interesting thing is, if I look here, doesn't show an error. It tried to do that. There's no such color as false, so it just didn't do anything. All right. So for that reason, actually, the fact that it's not typed isn't good, because you can give any kind of values to functions, and the functions will try to do it, and they might not do exactly what you want them to do, and they might not report an error either. All right. I'm going to save this, and I'm going to save it as another example because we're going to do something else. We're going to write a function that has two arguments, but instead of two colors, we're going to give it the name of an ID and the name of a color. All right? So let's go and save this as example two. Let's say we no longer want to change both of the sections at the same time. One time we want to change section 1 to red, another time we want to change section 1 to section 2 to yellow. In the first example, I gave as arguments the colors that I wanted. But I could also give as an argument the ID that I want to change. I'm just changing the names of the arguments just to make it more clear. Arg1 and Arg2 probably aren't the best name for argument names, because if you write a function with a bunch of arguments, you're going to look at it later on and say, what was Arg68? You know, who knows? Who remembers that, right? But if you give them descriptive names like this, like ArgID and ArgColor, you know ArgID holds the ID that you want to change. ArgColor holds the color that you want to change. All right. So I'm going to use this ID to point to a different section of the page every time I run this function. So I'm going to say I've changed this. It still has two arguments, but the two arguments are different things. In the first example, the two arguments were both colors. In this case, the first argument is a ID of what we want to change. The second is the color that we want to change it to. So I could say change first to red, change second to yellow. Save it. Change section 1 to red, 2 to yellow. All right. So in this case, the difference is that the first argument is the name of the thing that I want to change. The second argument is the color. Now this is very relevant to your assignment, right? Because you're going to have click events on something so that when you click on a tab, you make one of the tabs visible. Well, probably the best thing to do would be when you click on that tab, give the ID of the one that you want to make visible. All right? And then use the code to make that particular ID visible. Just like in this case, I'm using the code to make that particular ID red. Alright? So let's look at this. My function has two arguments, an ID and a color. Alright? So when I call the function, whatever is in the first position gets put in argID, whatever is in the second position gets put into argColor. Alright. So, document get element by ID, I no longer have a value hard-coded in there. Where am I going to get the value? Well, whatever the first argument I gave when I called this function, that's going to be put in the variable arg ID, and that's what I'm going to use. Again, note that there's no quotes around this. There's no quotes around this because we want the value of a variable. When you have a variable that you want the value of, you do not put quotes around it. If I put quotes around it, it would literally be looking for a section on the page that had a value for an ID of arg ID, like that. All right? If I were to put quotes around it. But if I don't put quotes around it, it looks for the thing on the page that has an ID that matches the ID in this variable. Well, what is the ID in this variable? Well, when we call the function, we supply that. And we supply that in the first position. What color are we going to change it to? We're going to change it to whatever's in the second argument, which in this case is red. So we can use the same function to change the first one to red or the second one to yellow, simply by giving arguments. Now again, what if I give something that doesn't exist? What if I type in 250 there? All right. Again, in other languages, you would get an error because you define the type of the arguments, and if the type doesn't match, you get an error. Here it's going to try and do that, but what do you suppose is going to happen? Okay, well, in this case, what's 250 going to get put in? It's going to get put into arg ID 1, all right? And it's going to look for something as an ID of 250. And is it going to be able to find something as an arg ID of, an ID of 250? No. So it's probably going to not give, it's probably going to give an error. So let's look. All right, didn't change. If we look at the error console, I don't see an error here. This is why I typically use Chrome, because the error reporting is better. Let's open this. It'll tell me, cannot read property style of null. And it tells us that on line 14 is where it gets the error. And it got initiated by the clicking on example 2 HTML page 30, or line 31. So line 31 is this one. When it tells us it can't read property style of null, what it's telling us is there's nothing on the page that matches this. There's nothing on the page that gives the ID that we supplied. All right? So therefore, this function didn't find anything on the page with the ID that we supplied. Therefore, it returned null. All right? It returned nothing. And you can't change the style of nothing. All right? So that's what the error message essentially is telling us. All right? In lay people's terms, we gave a non-existent ID, and therefore it gives us an error. All right, now we can change it. I said that whenever you have an assignment or a task to do, to take a look at what you need to do and sort of think through it and take a mental inventory of what you know and what you don't know. All right? So, let's look at our Lab 2 assignment. Has anyone completed Lab 2? Okay.
I did, but not with actually arguments.
Okay, so you did it kind of a brute force way.
Yeah.
That's okay. Because sometimes you can't clearly see the best way to do it until you do it a brute force way. So you do it a brute force way. And what do I mean by brute force way? I mean like the way we did this, where you have things hard-coded, all right? Whereas you might have three different functions. So let's talk about your assignment. Let's talk about how we could do it brute force and how we could do it maybe in a better way. So your assignment is to do this. Is to have, change your lab one to have tabs going across the top of the screen. Remember, your lab one was to have three sections of your page, one about JavaScript, one about PHP, and one about Ajax. So, I'm going to change that. To have three tabs. And when the page loads initially, we're going to show JavaScript. But as they click the other tabs, it's going to change to whatever they clicked on. So I click the PHP tab, we see PHP here instead. We click Ajax tab, we say Ajax. Now, let's talk about, first of all, just getting the visibility to work. Then we'll talk about changing the color. All right? What would be a brute force way to do this? Let's just talk about the visibility, and then we'll talk about the color. The brute force way to do this would be to have three functions, right? Have a show JavaScript, have a show PHP, and have a show Ajax. And when you clicked on this link, it called that function. Click on this link, it had that function. Click on Ajax, it called this function. What would the show JavaScript function do?
It should make the PHP and Ajax not visible.
Right. It would make JavaScript visible, make PHP and Ajax invisible. How can you do that? Well, we talked of two ways to do that. We could either make the display none for the invisible ones and the display block for the visible one, or we could set the visibility property to visible or hidden. And I think we talked about and decided the display of block and display of none is a better way to go, because when you make invisible, if I were to make this invisible and these two invisible and this one visible, if I use the visibility property, this one stays down here. Or if I use display of none, it would push it up so it would be in the proper position. So display of block versus display of none is probably the way to make them visible or invisible. So I would have three functions, and I'm just going to write it out. I'm not going to write the JavaScript function instruction out because I want you to have the fun for this. But essentially what I'd do is show JavaScript, hide PHP, hide Ajax. With PHP, what would I do? Hide JavaScript, show PHP, hide Ajax. And finally, with show Ajax, what I do? Hide JavaScript, hide PHP, and show Ajax. Again, that ought to be a little warning to you. because that looks like duplicate code. You're pretty much doing the same thing. The only difference is which one you're showing or hiding. All right? So how could we change this to make this more generic? How could we use an argument to make this more generic? So this is how to do it with three functions. Let's just do it with one function. But that function's going to have an argument. First of all, what are we going to pass as an argument? An ID. We're going to pass which ID? Right. We're going to pass the ID of whichever one we clicked on. The ID of the one that we want to show. So our function show is going to get an argument as of an ID. Alright? So when we click on this, we're going to call show, and we're going to give it the ID of whatever the JavaScript section is. When we click on PHP, we're going to call show, and we're going to give the argument of whatever PHP was, and likewise show, we're going to call that. Alright? We're going to pass Ajax in. So what's the content of this function going to look like? Well, we know the one that we want to show. Its name is contained in the ID. What do we want to do with the rest of them?
Display none.
Yeah. So, what we're going to do is, and again, I'm going to write down the approach. I'm going to hide all three of them. Why do I hide all three of them? It's going to make my code a little simpler. Because then, after I've hidden all three of them, I'm going to show the section in whatever the ID I passed in was. So we're going to start out, as soon as you click on something, we're going to hide all of them. Just to get all of them out of the way. And then we're going to show the one that we want to show. If you didn't do that, it would make the code a little messier. But we're just going to start off by hiding all of them, and then we're going to show the one that we want to show. So we're going to have one argument. To do this, we have one argument that represents the ID of what we want to show or hide. Or show. We're going to hide them all, and then we're going to show the one that we want to show. All right? Questions about this? Now, there's one other part of this, right? Do you remember what the additional part of this was?
Change the color of the tab.
Change the color of the tab. In other words, we're going to make the active tab a certain color. You know, maybe these are all yellow. Alright? We're going to make whatever tab is active yellow as well to show that it's active. And these maybe we'll make gray to show that they're inactive. And as we click on this one, we're going to switch that. We're going to make this gray and this yellow. Alright? So, how does that affect our function? Well, if we were hard coding it, we'd make JS yellow, make JS tab yellow, make PHP tab thing for these other functions, except which tab we're making yellow and which tab we're making gray. Well, guess what? We can do the same thing. We can give a second argument of the tab of the ID of the tab that we want to make yellow. Show and an ID for the tab that we want to change colors, because those are different pieces of our page. The tabs are separate from the section. Now we do the same thing. We're going to make all of them gray. And then we make the tab in our tab ID yellow. So we should be able to do this with two arguments. An argument for the ID that we want to show, and an argument for the ID that we want to change the color of. All right. And then, the onClick event will call our one function, we'll give it the ID that we want to show, and we'll give it the ID that we want to change the color of. All right. Because remember, the tabs always show. The section only some of the time shows. So the section is a different ID, is a different section of the page than the tabs are. So we simply have to tell both things. What section we want to show, what tab do we want to change the color of. Questions about this? All right. Onward and upward. There's a lot more we can do with functions. We have the idea, I think, now of functions, basic functions, changing things changing elements of the web page using the DOM, and we're just going to expand that by passing more arguments and by doing more JavaScript instructions. The one thing that we haven't talked about that we will talk about soon are return values from functions. So like if a calculation is done or if a process is done, we can return sort of like an answer. These functions, like we're writing here now, just go and do something. They don't really give an answer when they're done. But we're going to change that to write some functions that are actually going to return values. All right. We'll see you in lab.